How you doing? How are you both doing?
Oh, Tony, I'm so delighted. Thank you for making this special arrangement so that I could be here with my wonderful mother. This is my last night in Georgia. I have to go back to Florida tomorrow. I've got filming and people coming in and stuff to do. And I've been here, how long have I been here? Since the 10th of December. Yes. I've been here for a while. Mom's not happy at all about
I'm sure that would be tough to have you leave after being around that long. Definitely
we need to clone her.
Yeah, okay, talk to Elon Musk, Mom, because you know I don't have one of those machines, Mom. I want you to stay with us, Tony, because I'm sure as we're talking questions will come up for you as well. And so I just want to let the audience know that even though it is February, what day is it? It's the 2nd, February 2nd, that we're filming this, you're recording it so that we can put this out at, you know, in the right time slot and at a later place where I can hop on and be in the chat while people are watching it and answer questions.
Correct. Yeah. So can I. So we can both be there. That'll be actually kind of cool.
Yeah, it sure will be. And I really appreciate you making special time to do this tonight.
My pleasure.
There's just nobody on the planet that means more to me than this woman. And we've had some strange encounters together in our lives, haven't we?
Yes, indeed.
Yes, but there were a few things that happened, you know, and I know I've told all my viewers and my people that because A Wonder to Behold, the latest book, I needed to experience the paradigm shift. I needed to experience 2020 to be able to like complete the volume, you know? So
sure.
Mom has been really helpful about that. And over the course of this last year, as I've been writing about my experience of the paradigm shift, which the whole book was like a precursor to, and then I added on to the last chapter. So I've turned all that into my publisher, and I have a few little changes left to make, but it's coming. And it will be phenomenal, but it's going to have some stories in it that were not in the original book because they happened this past year. They happened. And one of them is my mother telling me about an experience that she had when she was about 11 or 12 years old that I very much wanted her to share with my viewing audience, and it got included in the book. And that there's a couple of things, there's several things that we need to talk about tonight. So if you would tell the folks about Auntie Eliza coming to visit and what she and my grandmother Gussie had to say and what you overheard and when you questioned her about it, what she said to you when you were living in a log cabin in South Georgia as a child.
Yes. Aunt Eliza came to visit, and as any child will do, I listened to the conversations between the two sisters. And they started to speak about an event that occurred with them, and my ears picked up, and my aunt and my mother talked about walking home one day from up the road, and they were up at the very top of the hill, and they were looking miles away at the top of another hill, and they saw a vessel, and it was something they'd never seen before, could not, you know, articulate what it was, couldn't even guess what it was, but it was made out of gold, and it was shooting golden sparks.
Wow.
And
they were younger, weren't they? They were walking as younger women or yes, girls.
Yes.
So this was, Eliza came over and they started talking about an experience that they had had as younger women or, you know, like girls when they yes. were much younger.
And my mother said to my aunt Eliza, "We saw Jesus. That's the only connection they could make to something that spectacular and that unusual."
Sure.
We saw Jesus.
And then when Mom got up the next morning, she went to my Grandma Gussie and she said, "Mom, you know, I heard you, the two of you talking last night. What were you talking about?" And then she reiterated with, you know, great excitement, "I saw Jesus."
Wow.
You know, that to me, that just blows my mind. It blows my mind. You know, it's just amazing. And, you know, yes, they didn't have the vernacular. They didn't have, you know, the words that we use now to describe these kinds of encounters or extraterrestrials right. or anything like that.
Well, and, it wasn't discussed, you know. It's only been in the last 30-some years that it's actually been discussed on a normal basis. So, yeah, it wasn't talked about. So, you're right. Those terms weren't in use. They weren't known. You're absolutely correct.
But, you know, from doing all these shows with me, that I think the only plausible explanation for Jesus Christ is that he was an extraterrestrial that came to the planet to teach us how to live lovingly together and not kill each other. And so we murdered him. You know,
that's what we do.
Yeah, in the most horrendous way.
Yes.
Yeah. And, you know, and yet his message has endured the test of time. And, you know, the basic message that he gave us was the golden rule to just love others and be kind and be thoughtful and be generous and be good and love thy neighbor as thyself. And, you know, so anyway, I thought that was phenomenal. And of course, I had to include it in the book. I had to.
Absolutely. That is amazing.
Yeah. Well, there's a story in the Bible, and I read the Bible through at least four times from cover to cover. And our local minister, my minister, was a well-educated man, and he taught us the Bible as history. And I remember a passage where Jesus is walking through the streets of Jerusalem, and he looks over, and leaning up against one of the buildings is somebody with that dreadful disease.
Leprosy.
And he was cold, and he was shaking, and Jesus took off his cape, and he went, and he wrapped it around this man, and put his hands on his head, and blessed him, gave him a blessing. Tell him about your encounter at the four-way stop.
Oh.
Yeah, tell him. It's okay if you cry. It's okay if she cries.
I'm such a crybaby. So the reason that Mom remembered that passage was because this afternoon she was building us a fire in the other room in our wood stove here, and it's been very cold here. The last few days have been miserable, and I'm Floridized, and so she's doing everything in her power to keep me warm. And I sat down on the sofa, and I looked over at her, and I said, "Mom, something happened yesterday, and I feel the need to tell you about it." And she said, "Well, honey, you know, what is it?" And I said, "Chris and I were out running around. We had a couple of errands to do. And we were on our way home, and not far from here, there's a three-way stop. And there was a man there who was, he was a small man, obviously aged. He had a white beard. He looked a little scruffy, but he had a coat on, but no hat, no gloves. And the wind was whipping. 20-30 miles an hour. Yeah, it was terrible. Like below freezing, certainly, with the wind chill. And he had a little cardboard sign that said, "I'm hungry, I think I'm dying." And my heart just, I looked over at this man, and I pushed the window down on Christine, was in the passenger seat, and I pulled off the side of the road, and I grabbed my handbag. And I said, "Chris, do you have any cash? Do you have any cash?" She said, "I got a little bit." I said, "I know I've got some cash." And I opened my wallet and I pulled out all I had, which was a $20 bill. And I handed it out to this man. And you would have thought that I had given him $2,000. He was so grateful. And he had the most piercingly beautiful blue eyes. And I could see his aura. I could tell that this was a man who had worked hard his whole life and had come upon bad times. His sign was written in crayon, which might have been all he had access to. And I just handed the money over to him. And I said, "I'll keep an eye out for you. I'll help you more. This is all I have." And, you know, Chris and I were like, "Oh my God, oh my God." I mean, had this been my house and, you know, and my mom were keeping everybody away from her because of the COVID and all of that until she gets her second dose, I would have put him in the car and I would have brought him home and fed him and clothed him and helped him in any way that I could have. And as we were pulling away from him and I'm saying, "Oh, God bless you. Dear God, bless you. Just go someplace and get warm. Go someplace and get some food." And he promised that he would. And, you know, I felt as we were driving away like I had patted a little wounded puppy on the side of the road and then left it there to fend for itself. The urgency in me to help this man. But I had stopped the whole line of traffic behind us, and I noticed in the rearview mirror that others were opening their window and passing money to him as well because they saw me do it. And I hope and I pray for him. But I must have that little Jesus gene in me because I want to rescue every animal, every person, every living thing that needs help. And so I came home and I told Mom about it this afternoon because I was too emotional to even tell her about it last night. And you know, she said, "You know, don't worry, you did what you could." And it felt so inadequate. You know, it felt so inadequate. And I looked for him again today when I had to go out and I got extra cash just in case, but I didn't see him. But you did
help, and you also showed others that you were helping and caused them to help. So what you did, Andrea, was the start of something unbelievably beautiful for everyone else to follow as well. You helped someone that, like you said, was down and out of on their luck and in a horrible situation, and you did everything you could for that moment to help, and made other people help as well. You can't ask for more than that.
Well, it runs in the family because this woman taught me a long time ago what compassion and empathy and true love for humankind is. And I couldn't have had a better teacher.
No.
I couldn't have. It's not even possible. So anyway, we had this past summer. I want to get to her second story, which is just so great. I told her, I'll keep you to three stories, Mom. I won't keep you forever and ever and ever. But she called me. I was with my father, and we were up in Inverness, Florida, going to visit Nancy. And my mother called me out of the blue. And my mother never calls me because she's afraid that I'm going to be in the middle of an interview or she's going to disturb me. And I tell her all the time, Mom, I don't care what's going on. I don't care. If you want to talk to me, you call me. So she calls me. I picked up the phone immediately. I said, is everything okay? Because, of course, you know, I'm total panic mess if, you know, she calls me. She's like, the most phenomenal thing just happened. And, you know, so I asked her what, and she said she was laying on her bed, and all of a sudden it was like the stereo had been turned on. She was home alone, or she thought she was home alone, and that Christine wasn't home from work yet. And all of a sudden she starts hearing the music from Tommy from The Who, the rock opera Tommy. The song See Me, Feel Me, Touch Me, Heal Me, so loud that it was mind-boggling how loud it was. And she's, you know, like, why is this happening? Why is this happening? And she just laid in bed and listened to it and listened to it. And I said, oh, Mom, that's one of the songs in the ET playlist of the new book, A Wonder to Behold. And she said, I read the whole book from cover to cover. I don't remember seeing it in there. And I said, well, you go back into the ET playlist. It's there. See me, feel me, touch me, heal me. At the same time that that was happening to her, I was talking to them, telling them to watch over my mother.
Wow. Wow. That's amazing.
Yes. We have some amazing connections. Yes.
I would say you do, absolutely. That's incredible, though. I mean, what a wonderful experience, not only to have that happen, but to know that they're there and they're watching, keeping an eye out. And, you know, Andrea asked for something and boom, you get a sign right then and there. That's incredible.
Well, you know, Mom had been struggling with a lot of pain. And it was the only thing that from the distance that I was, that I felt like I could do. And it was almost like I felt her pain. And when I did is when I was not driving. I was a passenger and I just looked out the window and I just looked up at them and I said, you know, please go to my mother. Take care of my mother. I'm fine. Dad's fine. We're fine. Go to my mother. And that music just burst through the whole house. And she thought Christine had come home and turned the stereo on and the volume was set up too high or what. Because we're, you know, we're big Moody Blues fans. We're old hippies. We're old hippies. I mean, you know, give me some The Who. Give me
Crosby,
Stills, Nash and Young. Yes, Carry On. Love is coming to us all. Yes. Yeah, we're old hippies is what we are. It's just how we are. And then a couple of days later, she calls me, and I should have had the presence of mind to pull it out because I've got it right over here in my computer bag. But a couple of days later, she calls me again, and I'm like, oh my God, what's going on now? And she said, you know, Ann, I was just in my room and something told me to go open the bottom drawer. Remember the bottom drawer of my dresser? And just go open the bottom drawer of my dresser. And when she did, she found a notebook that was one of mine from high school.
Wow.
That she didn't know she had not seen for decades. and it was laying right on top of her keepsakes. And she pulled it out and she opened it to a poem that she wrote to the Galactic family back in like 1972, the night that we saw. Tell them what we saw that night when we were doing the dishes. You and I saw them first. We didn't have curtains in the windows. There was no need. We didn't live near anybody. So
Right.
Oh, yeah. You mean the thing that traveled across the whole sky in 5 seconds?
Yes, that.
Yes.
You're tucking a little closer so that you show. Okay, there you go.
Yeah, we were sky watchers because it was a great place to watch the sky.
Yeah, no street lights at all. Nothing but the Milky Way and the moon. That was it.
Right. And I don't know why, but we went outside.
We know you saw it through the window while we were doing dishes and said, what the hell is that?
Then we went outside.
I followed you outside. And then everybody else in the family followed us outside. But it was amazing. There were three of them, remember?
Yeah. Traveling.
Vast distances
in seconds from one horizon to the next, clear across the earth in seconds.
But they were doing it in a very organized way, like they were mapping the earth, or they were creating some kind of a grid or something.
Yes,
and they were communicating with each other. And then, so at that point, we were out there. I don't know how long we were out there. A long time. We were all freezing our asses off. It was like August and we were freezing to death. And, you know, nobody said anything in the family. I don't remember anybody saying anything to each other. We just were mesmerized by what we were watching.
I'm sure.
And then they all came together in one place in the sky. And then as though they just had a little tete-a-tete and decided, okay, our work is done here. And in a split second, all three of them took off in different directions and they were gone.
That's incredible. Was this the first time you had seen something like this type of craft? Or was it something you had seen in the past?
I had never seen anything like that in my life.
No. And they were at such a great distance, you couldn't... You know, you couldn't see them as a craft. You only saw them as light.
Okay.
But nothing in the sky moves at that velocity.
No.
Except our galactic family. Nothing else does.
Right. Absolutely. Yeah.
And with that kind of innate intelligence, and my father, the king of understatement, when it was over, he's like, well, I guess the show's over. Let's go back inside. Okay, because like this was really important, Dad. You know, this something tells me this was really important, you know? And he's so nonchalant about these things, or he overreacts. It's one or the other. It's never down the middle. And so we went back in and we finished the dishes.
Yes.
And then there was one night. Now I had already seen the flotilla of ships had passed over the farmhouse, but that was like the year before. And I hadn't really said anything to anybody about it because I didn't know what to make of it. And we were dealing with other things in the farmhouse.
Yes, quite a few
other things, you know. And I didn't want my mom to worry. And she's the one that I would have told. So it was that night that we sat together in the kitchen when all the dishes were done and everything was shut down. And I told her that night about seeing the ships pass over, and I didn't say much other than I had seen things like that only really close up coming right over the farm. And she was like, oh, really? You know, like, oh, wow. You know, that's because, you know, that's my mom. Oh, tell me more. And then that same summer, you and Cindy and Christine were standing in your bedroom. The windows were open. The garden was coming in. The corn was very high. We had a whole like a quarter of an acre in the garden that was just butter and sugar corn.
Yes.
And this vessel, and I walked into the bedroom because they were all staring out the window and I wanted to see what they were looking at. So there was four of us and they're looking out the window, and Mom had turned off one of the lights in the room so she could see better. And this vessel came in, and it was about maybe 2 feet in circumference, maybe 2 feet. It was about that high. It had panels along. It looked like one of the Apollo shots, only with the whole top of the cone like shaved off. So it looked like shaped like this. It had panels of light all the way around it. It had a band of light under the panels of light. The lights were all flashing, beautiful colors, some colors I had never seen before. And it came in from quite a distance, and it came and it landed right in our garden. And really? It stayed for right in the corn. Yeah. And it only stayed for a few seconds, and then choom, it was gone. It was just gone that fast. In a split second, it was gone. And Cindy still talks about it, and Mom remembers it, and I remember it like it happened yesterday. And Christine has no recollection of it at all.
Really?
Completely blocked it. Like, I'm not going to think about this. I'm not going to worry about this. I'm not going to even consider this.
Yes.
Christine is the one that struggles the most with this stuff. She is. All right, you're going off screen again. Get over here. I don't have the COVID, honey. I'm safe. Don't worry. It's my doggy with the COVID kisses. Oh, my God. Right up the nose. Oh, unbelievable. So, yeah.
That's
so
a that fascinating happened. Story, though. And I remember Steve Bassett asking you a very similar question about what you experienced first. Was it the paranormal or was it UFOs and extraterrestrials? And you know, I was real curious to hear your response to that. And when you said they kind of happened simultaneously, hearing that story, that's just amazing. Just absolutely amazing.
Well, you know, it was almost like the spirits in the house. It was almost like a gateway, like it opened the third eye for us to be able to see beyond the fourth dimension into the fifth dimension and beyond. Do you have that?
We had some very amazing, remarkable, inexplicable things happen in the house. Some of them were terrifying.
I'm sure.
And but all the events that occurred, like with the ETs outside in the sky, were beautiful.
Beautiful.
And lightning and not frightening to me at
no,
all.
No, not threatening or frightening at all to any of us, except for Chris, who blocks it. You know, but Cindy's had experiences. My father's had numerous experiences. My mother. But my mother called me last August. July and August were very busy months. And, you know, we've talked about this on the show, Tony, about how so many people are seeing so much and what's right. going on. And, you know, are we just free? Do we have more free time to look up, or, you know, are we being contacted, or, you know, what's going on? What's the connection? What's happening that so many people are reaching out to us saying that they're having spirit experiences in their homes and they're having ET contact?
Yep.
So my mother, I love you so much. My mother calls me again in August and says, Annie, you know, I have seen incredible and remarkable things in my life. I have never, ever seen anything like what I saw today.
Wow.
Yeah.
So tell them the story. And then I sent you the picture, right?
You did.
After she describes it, I'm going to have you put it up on the screen so people can see what she drew, what she saw.
Absolutely.
We have drapes in the front that faces the front of the house and the street. So Sammy kept my little dog kept running and nudging the drapes aside to try to see outside. I said, okay, I'll open the drapes. So I went over and pulled the drapes open, and my eyes almost flew out of my head because here was this vessel. I mean, it's plain as day. When you see it, I drew it in detail.
He did, because I sent him the picture.
Oh, okay.
It's technology, Mom. We've got it under control, right, Tony?
We got it.
I stayed there on my knees until I couldn't stay any longer because my knees were hurting.
We have a settee in front of
settee.
So she was kneeling on the settee. And then today she remembered that Sammy went nuts. He saw it too.
Yes, that's why we're trying to get the drapes on him. Yep. He could sense it.
Yeah.
And he got all excited and tail is wagging like this. And then he hopped down, ran around all the chairs, came right back. And he did that.
Here, let me move the soda before you send it flying.
He did it.
Mom's a little excitable right now. Yeah.
Like he did it like 10 times. Like he had to come back and look again because he couldn't believe
what he saw.
No, he couldn't believe his eyes either. And I stayed for 45 minutes at least. And I started counting the ribs of the vessels. And then Sammy come jump up on the sofa and I lose my counter. I'm saying, Sammy, get out of here. I'd start counting the ribs. Again,
she said it looked like a fish, a long fish that had vertebrae, like the skeleton of a fish.
And I know because I grew up on the river and I dressed many a fish, so I know what a skeleton of a fish looks like.
Right.
And that was my first impression. Oh my God, that's the skeleton of a fish in detail.
Wow. Where's the envelope that you drew it on?
Oh, I didn't.
Hold on just a second.
Sure.
She was
45 minutes, it says there.
Yeah. And so she didn't have a camera handy. She got a letter from Nancy Pelosi. So she takes the back of the letter and she starts drawing this thing that she sees on. You see it?
Yeah.
And it has, you know, and it's got all kinds of other writing on it and phone numbers and stuff, because that's how we roll here. Grab the closest piece of paper. And, but she said that it had vapors shooting. I'll send it as close as I can, that it had vapors. She wrote the word out of both ends of it. And she said that this thing here looked like it had eyes. Like it had eyes, but it wasn't eyes.
Windshields.
Sure.
And so I asked her if she would, draw it out larger so that I could photograph it and send it to you so that we could share it with everybody tonight. Sammy kept running around in circles, very agitated, very animated. And Mom, you really told me you lost track of how long you were there, but it was at least 45 minutes or an hour.
Yes, until I couldn't stand it anymore on my knees.
Yeah, and she kept saying to me, why didn't anybody else see this? You know, why isn't there stuff all over the internet about this? Annie, go on Google. Go to the Google machine and search for, you know, this date for you know, something in the sky on this date and see if there's anything that's up there. And there wasn't. And I said, Mom, I can already tell you, I know that there won't be, because that vessel was for you. That vessel was for you to see and for Sammy to see. And and so when it was ready to leave, it telepathically read her mind, right?
Yeah.
When that was it and the knees were giving out.
It drifted up. Just very gently into a massive cloud of cumulus clouds and was gone.
Wow. That is amazing. And for, you know, 45 minutes to an hour for it to sit there. I mean, yeah, that was definitely directed right to you and was a display for you. Yes. All right, I'm gonna bring that photo up.
Yes.
Here it comes. And okay. they can still hear you. The photo will cover the screen, but yep. we can okay. still talk. But here it is.
You did a really nice job huge. On that.
Yes, yeah, the
was huge.
Yep. Absolutely
I
huge.
I tried to sketch in some of the houses down below to give you
to scale.
To give you
perspective. Scale. Yeah, that's huge. Wow.
And I kept seeing the two black darts. And I said, they look just like
eyes.
And the skeleton looks like it's a gutted fish.
Right. Yeah. It looks like ribs and like you said, the windshield being the eyes. But and yeah, the I see the vapors you have coming out. And the vapors were coming out of both eyes.
Front and the back.
Yeah.
Wow.
And they increased when it was ready to lift up into the cloud that had kind of moved in over it. Because when she first saw it, she told me there was nothing in the sky
clear
at all.
Clear blue sky,
just the vessel. And then this enormous cloud moved in on top of it. And when she was ready to be done, because her knees were bothering her and she was really starting to feel the pain of kneeling in one place for that long, as soon as she had the conscious thought, okay, I have to go now, it went away.
That alone is amazing, let alone the whole story in its entirety, but wow, that's incredible. What an experience that must have been.
I almost picked up the telephone and called 911.
Oh, honey. Were you scared?
No. But
you just wanted somebody to photograph. She didn't have a damn camera with her.
Right.
And she wouldn't have gotten up away from it to go find one.
Right.
There's at least three of them in the house. But no, she wasn't. It was almost like she told me it was like she couldn't leave. Like she had to just be watching it. And I told her, I said, you know, you had a close encounter, Mom. You had contact, you know, and you might have even not been here the whole time. That vessel, you know, I mean, my father has seen a vessel very similar to that one. And he was so freaked out when he woke up on the futon. He jumped up, he bolted upright. And I just happened to walk out of my office into the front foyer and I saw him. And he looked like a terrified little boy. I mean, just the look on his face. But my mother, it takes a whole lot to scare my mother. A whole lot. And he said, it was right here. It was right here in the yard. It was right here. And it went into the neighbor's yard and then it disappeared. And he described it exactly to me. Exactly what a long tubular vessel and, you know, everything that he saw. And it had a red line through the middle of it, which is similar to the ones that I've seen that had a red, like a bar through the middle of them that was bright red. And I took him out onto the foyer, out of the foyer onto the terrace and sat him down and let him talk to me about it for, you know, to describe it in depth. And I put that story in the book. And I said, Dad, did it ever occur to you that they were just dropping you off? And that was like, wow. Yeah, he wasn't even prepared for that. He wasn't. Well, he thought he was napping.
But how possible is that? I mean, it's very possible. There's so many stories of people, and you were talking about Christine saying that, you know, she never talks about it. She has no memory of it. The question is did she block it herself because it was too emotional for her, or did they block it for her knowing that it wasn't something she could handle? And you're right. Maybe your father, you know, didn't just wake up on the couch. Maybe he was dropped off, and who knows how much time went by for your mother or for your father in between those moments.
Yeah, well, all of us have had some lost time. in our lives, time that we cannot account for. That's just gone. I can't think of anybody in the family who hasn't expressed that experience at one time or another. And I thought it was interesting what Steve Bassett said last week about, you know, are we absolutely certain that everything that we experienced at the farmhouse was spiritual in nature, was ghost-like, you know, being that these entities can walk through walls,
right?
These entities can shapeshift. These entities, and, you know, there were so many times we questioned, you know, what did we just see?
The little black dog that ran through the wall.
Yeah, we had a cat too.
We had really?
Little black dog. I forget the breed, but it was small and thick hair. And if you're at the corner of your eye, you'd see it, and he'd take off, run across the kitchen, run through the wall.
Wow.
That'd be like 3 times. Yeah. I saw that little dog.
And I saw the cat that went through the door that used to be from your bedroom into the bathroom, and then Dad closed that wall off and made it just a single entrance bathroom. But for that cat, that door was still there.
And yeah, that happens a lot too, where spirits will use old hallways, old doorways, and that's a common occurrence. That's amazing.
Well, in their dimension, that's
it's how still there.
It's that still there.
Right.
Yes. Yeah. So, needless to say, over the course of the summer and into the fall of last year, as we were fighting our way through COVID and trying to take care of each other and watch out for each other. Mom's been having these extraordinary circumstances and experiences. And so every single one of them was a stop the presses moment, you know, like hold that publication because obviously it's not done yet. And so I have included the beautiful poem that my mother wrote to them the night that we saw the light grid in the sky. And it's an amazing thing. It's an amazing thing to have.
It
just showed up in her keepsakes when she hadn't seen that. That had my name in it. It was my notebook. She just grabbed a notebook and that night sat in the kitchen and wrote this poem to them and how they need to help us get past this, you know, constant wars and constant killing and, you know, all the pain and the suffering of humanity and come be with us, love us. I mean, it's a beautiful, beautiful poem. And I've included that with that story in the book.
Awesome. That's fantastic.
My mother has contributed to everything that I have ever written in extremely meaningful ways. Extremely meaningful. And she's the only one who I wrote my trilogy, House of Darkness, House of Light, here. And so every day, I'm like, Mom, here, read this chapter. Mom, did I miss anything in this chapter? Here, Mom, sit down. I'll read this to you. You know, I mean, she was. And she's the one that titled the books. And she walked over to me at the desk one day and she said, what are you going to call it? And I said, I don't know, Mom. I'm so busy writing it. I haven't even thought about that yet. And she just crossed her arms and cocked her head a little bit. And she said, House of Darkness, House of Light.
Oh, wow. And what a perfect title for it, because that's exactly what it was. That's just amazing. Both of you, that is absolutely amazing.
She's the light of my life. I told her she can't leave me. She can't go anywhere because I don't know how to be me without her. I don't.
Yeah, I understand.
As close as two human beings can be and still be in separate bodies.
Pennies from heaven.
Yes.
Your art will April throws us pennies from heaven.
She does. She does. In fact, I had just vacuum cleaned the rug in here the other day, and I when I vacuum clean, I put my whole back into it, don't I? I mean, there are not a speck on the rug when I'm done. And a few minutes later, she comes walking into the room and she's like, oh, look, a penny from April. I said, there's no way, Mom. Where'd you find it? She said, on the rug in the dining room. I said, there's no way. I just vacuum cleaned that rug. That rug is completely clean. If there had been a penny, it would have gotten sucked up into the vacuum cleaner and made a hell of a lot of noise. That penny just got placed there.
And would have had to have been.
For anything.
No, we don't need to bring change
into the house. We don't.
Right.
You know, wow. It goes into the transom in our cars in case, you know, wherever we get stuck and need, or we come across somebody on the side of the road that could use some help and there are no bills in the wallet. You know, I mean, so we keep all of our change in the cars.
Yeah. Well, and that's a perfect reason for them to do stuff like that, because they know it's going to stand out to you. They know you had just vacuumed. They know you don't have change laying around the house that could just randomly appear. So they're giving you signs that they know you're going to, pay attention.
I have found pennies on the floor at the floor.
Had just been vacuumed. Yeah. Yeah, wow. April's around us a lot.
That's why I call them pennies from heaven.
Sure. They are.
Well, we're making an assumption that April's in heaven. She was a hellion in life. So, yes. You know, fingers crossed, we're hoping for the best for her. But she was, we miss her very much. And we think about her and talk about her all the time. And when she comes around, almost always, she comes around my father a lot. I think she's really kind of worried about him, especially when I leave him alone for weeks and weeks at a time because I'm up here with my mother. Well, again, no cloning machine. I can't be in two places at once.
Right.
You know, Dad wants me for company, but my mom needs me. There are times that Mom needs me. And so this has been one of those times. But when I'm not down there, my father will walk through the house and all of a sudden he gets this whiff of gardenia, strong. We always called it her old lady perfume.
Yeah.
You know, it's like she'd substitute it for a bath. You know, I mean, really, it was, oh, I'm going to Mom's house, spritz, 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 you know, good to go. And because she knew when she got down here, she was going to be gardening and sweating and, you know, she'll take her shower here. And so we'll get a whiff of April in the air, her gardenia, her old lady perfume, and then find.
She'll wake me up if she thinks I'm sleeping too deeply. She'll come nuts in the bed and say, Mom, and I lurch up out of sleep. Mom. One day she said, Mom, wake up. Just as though she was standing right next to my bed.
Wow.
Yeah.
She wants to keep me around so I can keep her out of trouble.
No, she doesn't want you to go where she is because then you really will keep her out of trouble. She's probably bossing God around, Mom. I mean, think about it. You know how what an Aries she is. Jeez, yes. Louise. So, you know, all I know is that I am happiest. I am most joyful when I'm with my mother and we play Scrabble and we talk about old times and we have experiences together and we go on nice days and we go and sit out on the deck. And one of my vessels is always due north. It's like, it's always in the same exact place, always. And so we'll go out there in the morning with our coffee and a cigarette and I kind of prop myself due north. And while we're talking, I'm looking and then flash, there it is, flash. And Mom will see it and she starts, you know, blowing cosmic kisses. And she's like, that's your ship. I was like, yeah, it is. It's one of them. There it is.
Wow. We saw that spectacular thing over the airport.
Yes.
And it was green. It was blue.
It was yellow.
It was purple. It was purple. And it was just an orb.
Yeah.
And it stayed there, and we called Cindy so she could go
out and look. Yeah.
And Chris came out.
And again, has no recollection of it. None. But she saw it. She saw it too. And it was there for the longest time. Hovering above the Atlanta airport. You know, why were there thousands of pictures of it all over the internet?
Right.
You know, I mean, it was an amazing vessel. It was beautiful. And as the crow flies, we're only about maybe 30 minutes from Hartsfield.
Yeah.
You know, and there it was. And, you know, the next day we're talking about it. And Christine's like, what are you talking about? And we're like, what? You came out and you saw it with us. And so I put something on Facebook about it. And Christine's smart ass response was, yeah, that's the fifth runway. No, it's not the fifth runway. Nothing taking off the fifth runway. It was well above the airport, but it was directly above the airport. And, you know, anybody that's an aficionado of extraterrestrial sightings and things knows that all of our nuclear sites are monitored, all of our airports are monitored. You know, anything where stuff's coming and going of our technology, they're there.
They're keeping an eye on, right? They have
the ability to cloak in such a way that only we, the seers, can see them. And nobody else does. Or if they do, they don't remember. And that's something. That's something to do more research on. And, you know, and then when we have sightings, I get wicked downloads. I get like high pitched noises. I'm like, hold on. I'm getting a download. Hold on. You know, and I just kind of close my eyes and let the information come in. And honest to God, I don't know what they're saying to me. It's going into my subconscious mind. But I do know that they're saying something, because when I'm lecturing about this, or even in conversation, I'll say something that obviously came from them. It was not a conscious thought that I had before I spoke it aloud. It just came through and out. And very often, you know, in front of 1,000 people at a time, like, oh God, this is being filmed and there's a lot of people here and I can't take this back. You know, and I don't know, you know, I don't know where it comes from, but there it is.
Sure.
Your daughter's a weirdo, Mom, but you know, you know.
Can I be excused?
You may be excused.
To go ever to that.
I know, sweetheart. Okay. So we are going
to. It was a pleasure to speak with you.
And likewise, Tony said that it was a pleasure to speak with you, darling.
Yes, and you as well, sweetheart.
Thank you.
Good night.
I'll be with you in about 5 minutes, honey. Yeah, Mom's a little hard of hearing, so I had to let her know, which sure, is why you. if it was a little loud, you know, it was. I've got.
No, you're fine. You're fine. Oh, okay. What a wonderful relationship that you have with your mother, and just, you know, to be able to share those types of experiences, especially when they're pushing the boundaries of what, you know, you consider to be normal. Just that's got to be extraordinary. But you were speaking just before your mother walked away about, you know, whether, you know, some people remember, some people don't. You know, the experiences your mother and you were talking about is they almost put on a show or a display for you, so that you could watch, you could study, you could see what they were doing. Yes. I mean, ships don't sit around for 45 minutes. So obviously the connections you have made, knowing that they're there, accepting that they're there, wanting to be included with what they're thinking about doing, or whether they're coming to announce that they're out there and so that everybody knows, but maybe they need to block that from some certain people. And that's why, like the one over the airport, nobody else saw, nobody else could see, but you guys could, because they don't have to block it from you. You
right.
Accepted it.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that could be the case. And, you know, it brings joy to my heart, Tony. It brings joy to my heart. I can't tell you. I mean, I feel like I've lived a charmed life, you know, and I know that Mom feels that way too. I know she does. That, you know, for the hardship, for the misfortune, for the grief, for the loss, for the sadness, for everything that we've experienced, for the terror that we sometimes experienced at the farm, neither of us would change any of it because it made us who we are now.
Exactly. Exactly.
And it opened us up. It was illuminating. It was enlightening in the extreme. It continues to be. And, you know, I've often said, if I never have another sighting, if I never have contact again for the rest of my life, it wouldn't for a moment make me doubt everything that I've already experienced. And I would always remain supremely grateful for the experiences that I've had. Because for me, it's not a matter of belief. It's not a matter of having faith in them. Right. It's knowing that we are not alone in the universe, knowing that. And as I said to Steve Bassett, there's nothing more important to me. There's just nothing that matters more than knowing this and being able to affirm and, you know, to be able to comfort people who are having experiences that maybe terrify them. But, you know, to let them know it's okay. You're being given a gift. You know, there are billions and billions of us on this planet, and there are millions of us who have had close encounters,
right,
whether it be with spirit or whether it be with the galactic family. We have had supernatural experiences. The experiences that I have had have been so numerous that there's nothing super about them anymore. They're just natural.
Just natural, right?
They're not para. They're just normal. And yet, so delightful, so energizing, so uplifting. So anyway, I just wanted to share my mom tonight. And I sent you some photographs of her. Were you able to load any of them?
They're all here.
They're all here.
You want me to go through them?
Yeah, go through them because they're family photographs that I thought that my viewers would like to see, and I can give you a little story with each one of them.
Great.
That's my mom when she was about, believe it or not, about 50 years old.
Wow.
Just stunningly beautiful woman. Yes. And it's when we had our, we had a restaurant together years and years and years ago from 80 something to 90 something. So yeah, it was a long time ago. And that was her Christmas Eve, probably around 1989 or 90. That was, she was unable to come to the set when they were filming The Conjuring. And so they sent a team to interview her. And that was a photograph taken in July of 2013 while she was sitting for the interview that ended up in the Blu-ray edition of The Conjuring DVD.
Ah, great, great photo.
Yes. And that's just before we were leaving. Oh my God, I look like a beluga whale. Okay, my mother, okay, let's just say my mother's extra, like, uber thin, and it makes me look bigger than I actually am. But that was just before we were going to leave to go out to Hollywood for the opening of the film, and she couldn't travel out there. She and April stayed home, and the rest of us went out to the premiere of the film, and these photographs were taken the day before we left.
Ah.
This is my mother at the age of maybe 28. And she was doing some modeling for a guy in Providence who brought this young upstart with him to do a session with her. And his name is Chris Christofferson.
Big name.
Yeah. Yep.
Wow.
I know. She's incredibly beautiful. And that was, again, just before we left to go out to the premiere of The Conjuring with my sister Christine. And that's my mom with her little dog, Coco, also known as Pootie, who passed away a number of years ago, several years ago. My mother cried for 3 months and said, I will never have another dog. That's it. I can't ever go through a loss like this again, ever. And then April, who was scheduled to go into the hospital to have surgery, came down with her little dog, Sammy, and said, you take care of Sammy while I'm in the hospital.
Aww.
And then she never came back. So now mom has Sammy. And that's Sammy. I know. Come here, baby. That's my baby. Okay. This is my baby. And that's right when we moved in 1980. When we moved from the farm and mom rescued some baby birds that had fallen out of their nest and raised them up, and they loved her dearly and they wouldn't leave her. And she was trying to get that one. You could see the joy on her face. I mean,
oh, yeah.
Baby oh, absolutely. Bird that she had rescued and overlooking the Salicoa Creek in Cherokee County, Georgia. And you know, we had just escaped from the farm. And as far as mom was concerned, it was an escape from the farm. And she was back in Georgia and she was blissfully happy. And she had saved the bird and was trying to get it to fly away and go ahead and go bye-bye. And it didn't want to hear it. And it came to visit her every day for years after that.
Wow.
Yeah. And that's when I was 15 years old. And mom and I were sitting on the bridge over the Nipmuc River that ran behind the farmhouse. And I was already way bigger than my mother at 15 years old. I've just got Amazon jeans in me. And this is a couple of years before we lost April. And I was cooking up a storm and all sweaty. And mom and I were in the kitchen making Thanksgiving dinner. And April showed up and started picking at all the food and saying, oh, let me test this, let me test that. So we had to, you know, slap her down and make her go in and watch the rerun of the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade. And she's got that look on her face like, I got to taste the turkey first. And that's April.
Amazing photos, just amazing.
Have a lovely evening. Thank you from the bottom of my heart.